So welcome to our gathering this morning. I'm Hannah, one of the leaders here. We've got a slightly quieter gathering here this morning, I think. We had Lighthouse yesterday with over 40 people, children and adults, gathering together to worship together. So we'll be a bit quieter this morning. If you have brought children, there are creative baskets and boxes for toddlers at the back, but we won't be having any groups for children today. I'm not going to highlight very much news today. I just want to encourage you, if you're not already on our email list and you want to know what our weekly news is, to get onto our email list. And if you're not on that list, please fill in a Get Connected card. Or if you're new to our gatherings and you want to know what's going on, please fill in a Get Connected card. We won't be taking an offering this morning, but if you do want to give, if you're part of our regular gathering and you want to give to the work of this church, then you can do that in a number of ways. We have a box for cash by the coffee hatch. There's a machine, card machine in the lounge, and you can also give by standing order from your bank, and there's forms for that on the welcome desk. So, yeah, if you want to know a bit more about what this church is about, there's all sorts of information over there on the Get Connected desk. Grab some information from there. But I just want you to be aware that looking forward into June, I really want to encourage you to put your Saturday evenings aside. When we've been gathering on a Sunday morning, we've been having such a wonderful time in God's presence, haven't we? We're just sensing that Sunday mornings once a week isn't quite enough. And I'm trying to remember how long ago, 8-10 years ago, we created the House of Prayer. At the top of the cottage across the driveway. If you've never seen the House of Prayer, I encourage you to go into that space. It's a wonderful space. It was three pokey little rooms, and we knocked it all through and created this space as a House of Prayer. And we really wanted this space to be one in which there would be a rhythm of prayer throughout the week, throughout the day. And the space is available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for prayer. But since we've established that, as I say, quite a long time ago, we've never really got going with a pattern of regular prayer and worship in that space. And we want to use June to try and get that going. And so what we're going to do is going to be lots of opportunities throughout June to come and gather together. We don't want to fill up your diary, so we're going to be encouraging small groups to be using their gathering times to gather in the House of Prayer as well. So there's going to be publicity coming out in the next week or so, and we're going to get going on Saturday the 3rd of June, will be the first time that we gather. And we're actually, having said we're using the House of Prayer, for that one we're going to be starting here in this space on the evening of the Saturday the 3rd of June. So do just put that in the diary and watch out for more publicity. Thank you.
Can I ask us to stand together, if that's okay, if you are able? Please, only if you're able. You can do this sitting. It's okay. Let me read to you from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord, the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart. How's your hands this morning? How's your heart? The one who does not trust in an idol. We've been putting our trust in stuff before we put our trust in God. Or swear by a false god. This is what it says. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. This next bit I'm going to read, and this is the bit I really wanted to underline this morning. I felt it was a call to us as we worship together. This was written, the context, I believe, I haven't studied this morning, but the context is the return of the ark, this symbol of God's presence to Jerusalem. So it's a symbol of God's presence returning to its rightful place. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, the King of Glory, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is he? The King of Glory, the Lord Almighty. He is the King of Glory. I felt as we prayed this morning that the Lord almost has given us handles on our hearts with which we can open up to him. So I wanted to encourage you to do that this morning, just to encourage you to open up your hearts to him this morning. Because he's there. I want to come in. I want to come in fully, wholly, completely. And the more you cleanse these hands, and the more you sanctify, you set apart this heart, the more you resist anything, any idol of the world, the more we do these things, the greater he will come. The more of his presence we will experience. So your hand is on the handle this morning. And I pray that as we worship and pray together, as we minister to one another, as we open up his word, we might just be opening the doors, the windows, the openings of our lives to him. So just pause for a moment and pray. Just express your sorrow of the things that have sullied your hearts and dirtied your hands. Just ask his forgiveness for the way you've put your trust in things that this world that just lead to nothing. Just say, thank you, Lord, that you forgive. I'm forgiven. And just say, I'm opening up my heart to you. Just invite him in. Holy Spirit, come. Make that your prayer this morning. Told that we can boldly approach the throne of God. Come, Lord Jesus. Thank you.
Jesus, we thank you that we can just call upon your name, the beautiful name, the wonderful name, the powerful name of Jesus. That name is everything. That name is everything.
Jesus blood.
just let those words sink deep. Wait on him for a moment. No rush. Father, we position ourselves to receive from you this morning. Lord, we've offered our hands and our hearts to be purified and cleansed, and we thank you that they are by the blood of Jesus. We've repented and turned from any idols that we might have lifted our hearts and minds, our actions too in these previous days. We've turned away from false words, foolish words that we may have spoken. And we believe we're ready to receive, Lord. We're right to receive. We posture, we position ourselves to open the door, to let you in more and more and more. Stand today on that cornerstone. Who Jesus is, what he has done, his death, his resurrection, the ascension that we celebrated in the church calendar this week, and the outpouring of his Holy Spirit that we will think about and celebrate and pray, Lord, receive next Sunday at Pentecost. But Lord, we're just ready, Lord. We just open the door of our hearts and we're ready to receive from you. We're ready to receive. Thank you for all that you've done already, but Lord, we know there's more. Come, Lord Jesus, come, we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come. As in your word, you're knocking at the door of our lives. You're waiting for us to open. And we open up now. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Do grab a seat. We're gonna worship more a little later. If you want to have the passage we're looking at today before you, you can turn to Romans 5. We're going to look at the first five verses. It dawned on me this week as I was preparing for today that I haven't really talked a lot about our trip to Kenya. We, at Christmas, raised some money to build a house for a family that we had become aware of, called Matua. Actually, it's not his name. They had to change his name for... just because it was posted online, and you don't put children's names online. So his real name is something else. I said, if I say it. It is his last name, is it? I can't remember. Is it? Anyway. But we had such a lovely time in Kenya. Steve and I went along with Tony, Linda's husband, and Adam, Linda's son. So there's four of us that went, and we had such a lovely time. Can we have that first slide up? We spent a lot of time working with the team at Tumani Kwa Watoto. This is a team of people who they rescue children, or they try and stop. Basically, they try and stop children getting to the streets, because once they're on the streets, it's very difficult to get them off the streets, or it gets increasingly difficult the longer that they're there. So they're increasingly working in the suburbs and in the provinces to try and grab these children. And what they do is they get them home and they put them with families, and they try and connect them with either, if the parents is not working there, it will be aunts, uncles, often grandparents that they are connecting with. And they've got 96% success rate. That's amazing, isn't it? 96% of children that they return home, because what they do is they take them home and they put them with the family, and then they mobilize the church and the village elders and the schools, and it works. So we became aware of this little boy called, we'll call Matua, and there he is on the side. And this is a family who are living in a slum house in a place called Juja, just outside Nairobi. And there were 16 of them in this little house, and Dad had just got himself into a right pickle with booze, and just basically had given up caring for his family. He just couldn't care for them, so he just sunk himself into booze, and they were in a desperate state. So little Matua was out on the streets begging, and the team find him, go home, and they said, well, we've got a plot of land in our village next door to Granny's house. If we could get there and if we could build a house, we'd go. So we raised a few grand at Christmas, and the team out there worked with the family and local people to build this three-room house. And while we were out in Kenya, we had the absolute joy and delight of going and being there when they moved in. So a few little pictures of it there. So you can't really see, but to the side, there's a nice plot where they can grow and have a toilet. And that was the family down the bottom there that all came to celebrate the day, and it was a wonderful day. I'm gonna show you a little clip. Can we go on to that next clip? Just to see some of my amazing dad dancing. And go forward a little bit. No, it's back and start, don't worry. So we had such a lovely time. And I said to Steve, because he was there as well, so did he want to say anything?
Hello. All right. Yeah, you asked me last night, do you want to say anything? I'm not going to say much, to be honest with you, but I looked through some of my photos. Most of them were of trucks with big wheels and upgraded suspension, 4.5 litre diesel engine. Anyway, then I looked through my notes. Most of it was about food. I love food. Actually, what I'd like to talk about is when we were there, with, as you can see from the video, with like the family, the volunteers, the local community. It was very united, and it was a massive, massive thing for that village, you know. And there were like a few lads that I were drawn to that were particularly like under the influence of whatever they were. I think they were drunk, or, and like, I really did feel drawn to them. And we managed to pray for them and lay hands on them, didn't we, Matt? We managed, like, during, when we sort of went into the house, we ended up breaking bread and, like basically leading some sort of communion. And we asked whoever wanted to come up, and we wanted to lay hands and pray for them. And out of the four guys who were just lurking around, you know, they were quite young, they were really, really drunk. One of four, I guess, kind of came in, and he generally wanted to receive. So he took the bread and drank the juice and let us lay hands on him. And I really felt the Holy Spirit move really deeply. And I was just really drawn to Mark 2, verse 17, where this is just it, isn't it? Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus is there for those boys. And, like, I really, really feel that they were, like, in fact, we just prayed. We just see it. We saw it time and time again in Africa. We saw it so much more prominently out there than maybe here sometimes. Like, I do see it in this country massively, but, like, out there as well, it's just like really raw. Yeah, it's so good. Like, I could go on and on, but I'm not going to.
It was life or death.
Yeah.
It was life or death. For this, particularly these guys, there were four of them. One of them was particularly bad. And this chap, we just felt the Holy Spirit was just on him, you know, and we started praying for him and he just started receiving. And I don't know where he's at now, but it was great to have that opportunity, wasn't it? So just wanted to show you a little of what you invested in and what the difference that you made, we made, in that place. And to hear Matua's parents and dad particularly saying, this has changed my life. This has changed my family's life. This has made a massive difference. And so it was, I think, great, humbling and a huge honor to be part of that on your behalf as a church. And it was lovely that I didn't know it was there, but we noticed on the stone going into the house, they've written, with thanks, City Life Church Truro. You know, so that's there forever to be seen. But that's not really what I wanted to talk massively about today. I just wanted to give you a little bit of an update on that. The main thing I wanted to talk about today, and use as a way of introducing this passage from Romans. Maybe if you wanted to, you could turn to it, just a few verses. I was going to read the whole chapter, but I think just the first few verses will do. So my Bible has the heading, Peace and Hope. It says, therefore. When it says therefore, usually means it's sort of coming out of, it's flowing out of what's gone before. And in this is a therefore to the previous five chapters. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, talked about that last week, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. When we were in Kenya, it's always important that we've been a few times now, so we've always made a point of going onto the streets of Nairobi, and there's a particular district that we find ourselves going to where there's a police station, and it's near the bus station, and it's a particularly crazy place, isn't it, Steve? You know, it's just a bit bonkers. to say the least. And we went to a police station there and met with some of the workers that the team work alongside, and it was, I'll be honest, it was quite traumatic what we experienced in that place and the child that we met there who had just been abandoned. But we went on from there into this market area, and we thought it would be, it's important as we celebrate with the team what they do, that we meet some of the children who maybe have slipped through the net. The children who have got to the streets and they haven't been able to rescue, because what it really does is it makes you realise what they are, why they're doing what they're doing. So if we could go on to that next slide, please, Grace. This is, it was a little group of 9 to 11-year-olds, 9 to 14-year-olds, something like that. Just 5 or 6 of them. And we met them in a sort of downtown Nairobi. And this is a little lad, well, a young man I got drawn to, just felt so, so sad for him. His name's Daniel. And it was obvious, just talking to him, that he had been on the streets for a long, long time. He'd actually been on the streets since he was 9. So from 9 till this point, he had been living in this terrible environment where, you know, it was a daily struggle to find food. It was a daily struggle with drugs. The main one is, was it jet fuel they were sniffing? How they got jet fuel? But it basically, they just sniff it all the time, constantly, constantly sniffing in a rag, yeah, or a bottle sometimes. Diet was very poor. And you could just see what 4 years of living like this had done to this 14-year-old. And so one boy who's the worker from the team is just absolutely brilliant. We start chatting to him, and I was absolutely shocked when I found out that his parents lived 3 miles away. And he had his mum's phone number. And we rang her. And I'm thinking, what's going on? This lad is living like this, yet family is an hour's walk away. It's complicated. It's not as straightforward as saying, there's the cab fare, get in a cab and go home. You need to work with the family. And, you know, one boy started that conversation. But he'd been there for 5 years. Yet his family were just a stone's throw away. I asked why, and he said, well, they'd fallen out over something a few years ago, and he just felt he couldn't return. I was shocked and upset about Daniel being so close to home, yet, and potentially, I don't know this for definite, we don't know what's at home, but in my mind, I'm thinking the guy is so close to home where life could be so much better with his family, yet he's choosing to turn his back on that and live in this very destructive and damaging environment, despite how close he is to that life he could live. And the reason I share this today in the light of this text is that Daniel had a place where he would be loved and cared for, but chose to live at a distance from that place with disastrous effects. So he had a place, but he chose not to live there. And the impact was just so destructive and so damaging. And I just thought to myself, how many people live like this in terms of their relationship with God? You know, Karen, you brought a word the other day about there is a place for us. And you read John 14. There's a place for us in heaven, but that place starts now. There is a place for us. There is a place for every person, I believe, who walks this planet. And it's as close as a step of faith. It's as close as a moment of revelation and belief that would draw us into that relationship with him. It's as close as that, but so many people live separate from it, with often and potentially disastrous effects. So that's the context I want to sort of, I've spent a long time, that was a long introduction, that. to this passage, but that's what I want us to keep in mind as we go through this. Last week we reflected on Romans 2, and this is part of the, you know, the therefore of Romans 5 is Romans 2, just two verses we looked at. And we talked about God's holiness, didn't we? And his intolerance, because of his holiness, there's an intolerance of sin. And then we looked at his commitment, his covenantal commitment, his connection, his love for us. And then how just pragmatically, because he's holy, because he's got this covenant connection, he had to do something. And he sent his son, Jesus, who died for us. And do you remember what happened when we broke bread? We came and knelt at the front because we didn't really know what else to do. We just had to give thanks to him because of what he's done for us. And we celebrated how we are justified, declared free from the power of sin, free from the pollution, the potential pollution of our sin that comes into our lives through the world, the flesh, and the devil. And we knelt before God and we just celebrated and we thanked him for what he did and is doing as we broke bread. I want to carry on. I want to give us a bit of a therefore today, because what I think we have in these first few verses, if you go on to the next slide, please, Grace. What we have in these first few verses, these four verses, is what it means, the implication, the impact of what it means to be justified by faith. So it's therefore, since we have been justified through faith, what does it say? We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We are brought near. The barriers, the blockages, the obstacles have been wiped away, so that we can have peace with God. We can come into that relationship with him. We can take our place. If we're going to use that analogy, that picture of Daniel, we can come home and take our place because of this thing that Jesus has done, with this declaration that God makes over us by faith as we accept what he's done. We're justified, declared free and clean, so we can come and be with God. And what happens is this: as we grow and appreciate and understanding our experience of what it means to have peace with God, we start to experience the peace of God. I don't think it's automatic, but it comes. As we grow and as we walk in our peace with God, we start to understand that we can have and experience the peace of God. There are a few things there I just want to underline from this passage before we spend a bit more time worshiping this wonderful God together today. So some of the implications of us taking our place, of coming home, that we read in these verses today. The first is we can stand in his grace. We can stand in his grace, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. God's grace is his undeserved, unmerited, divine enabling, his favor. We don't deserve it. We can't earn it, though often we try. But we can, this passage tells us, stand upon it. If you're able to, can I ask you to stand? Don't worry if you can't. You can just think about it. And the reason I'm asking you to stand is because I want us to think about this posture, this standing. I'm actually standing on the baptistry here, which is a bit wobbly and a bit wiggly at the moment. We try to make it less so, but it feels a little bit, if I disappear, you'll know where I've gone. In the original language, the meaning of this word to stand has a bit more to it than what we're doing right now, than just standing on our feet. Let me read to you what the sort of the dictionary that I read said. It says to stand, to make firm, to fix, establish, to cause a person or a thing to keep there or its place. To stand, to be kept intact, to escape in safety, to uphold or sustain the authority or force of anything. You know, today, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, if you have put your trust in him and you are justified by that faith, then you are standing on God's grace. You are standing on his undeserved, unmerited, hallelujah, that's good news, favor. Divine, godly, enabling and help. That's what you're standing on today. So whatever you face, whatever situation, circumstances are before you, what pathway is unfolding before you today, you are standing firm on God's grace. His divine, unearned, unmerited favor and strength, yeah? You're on it. Just think about that for a moment as you stand. Nothing that you can do. This is a work of God that comes as we trust in him. Please have a seat. So we stand on his grace. It's good, yeah?
Great.
But we revel. This is my take on the word. We revel. That means take great pleasure or delight in his glory. We revel in his glory. Apostle Paul uses the word boast. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. We boast in the hope of the glory of God. Living Translation, if you read it in that version, just puts us, it's translated a slightly different way, and it has a bit more of a future focus. It says, confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. There is a confidence in our future glory that we can really revel in, I believe. You know, when someone dies and they're in Christ, we kind of do that a bit at their funerals, don't we? We revel, we celebrate their faith in Christ and the difference that it makes in their death. We're only doing what I think the Apostle Paul does in 1 Corinthians 15. Let me read this. We often read this at different funeral services. For the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and will be changed, and we will be changed. This is talking about our future hope. New heaven and new earth stuff. You know, for the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality. When the imperishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up by victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is reveling in our future hope. But it's not just about that, you know, a phrase that Callie used to say this. Some of you know Callie and Scott. She said, it's not about pie in the sky when you die. It's about steak on the plate while you wait. Now, obviously, you're a vegetarian. That ain't such a good thing. There's something equally as pleasant that you would want to feast on. We're invited to a table here and now. You know, there'd be something beautiful about it when we go to be with God, when we meet him face to face. There is that moment where, you know, yeah, that's going to be the greatest of celebrations, but there's a feasting now, isn't there? There's an enjoyment, an impact to what is ours in the future that comes in and touches us in the present. It's about the hope of glory shaping how you live your life in the moment. As one of the early church fathers, his name was Athanasius, said this before, but I'll say it again. This is what he defines glory as. He says, the glory of God is man or woman fully alive. The glory of God is man or woman fully alive. It's when we start to shine, when we start to fully and truly live from the place that he lives within us, free from the influence and the impact of the world, the flesh, and the devil. It's when we live from the inside out, I of arise. And the more we do this, the more his glory will be revealed. So we revel in that glory. Yes, we celebrate what will come, but there's something about experiencing and entering into it more and more now. Paul says, doesn't he? You are being transformed from, and remember, one degree of glory to another. So we stand in his grace and we revel in his glory. But how about the last one? Tough one, this one. We glory in our suffering. We stand in his grace, we revel in his glory. But then it says we glory in his suffering. It says, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. Do you know the word glory here is the same word in the original language for boasting in the previous verse? We boast in our sufferings. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a bit odd. I'm not sure it's saying that we would be boasting that I have suffered considerably more than y'all. And looking around this room, I know many have suffered considerably. So I tread carefully as we come into this passage. I think he's not saying that we should be boasting in these things, obviously. But I think there are to come what define us. And I don't think that's what God is talking about here. When we get to that point, we can start to feel really crushed by them. And as I said, they can define us more than our identity in Christ. And I know that some of us, and I myself included, feel like this sometimes. And what I'm not saying here is what I believe this passage is saying, suck it up and get over it. That's not what God is saying here. What I think he's saying is that we're not in heaven yet. We're not in heaven yet, but there is still hope. We're not in heaven yet, so we are still subject. We're still subject to these impacts of the fallenness of our world. The impacts of death and separation and darkness, yes? We have to live with that and in the light of that all the time. So challenges and suffering will come. But as they do, what I think this passage is saying, we need to remember that we're standing on the grace of God. We're standing on the grace of God. We are in his presence, and he is revealing his glory. I do not believe that God does these things to us. I believe that they are a result and an impact of the fallenness and the brokenness of our world. I do believe that we can find him in the midst of it. And as we do, there is an opportunity for growth. And sometimes in these difficulties, there is an acceleration of that glory being revealed. But, and there is a but here, only when we choose to seek God in the midst of it. When we seek him, we celebrate the place we're standing, We remember the future hope that is ours, and we let that come and shape us in the moment. Do you know, this is a massive issue, and I kind of feel like I'm just scratching at the surface. And I know there are people in this room who could talk far more about this than I can. But I just want to say this, it's not an automatic thing that we grow through our suffering. We have to seek him in the midst of it. We have to wrestle at times, wrestle to find him. But as we wrestle from a place of being in his presence, stood on his grace, and journeying into his glory. And I think that's what this passage is about. Is that okay? Okay. So, I want to put the final verse up, and I want this to be the focus for our response today. So, guys who are leading us in worship, I'd like you to come back up if that's okay. And it's this, and hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. I'm going to do two things, okay? And hope does not disappoint us. So I just want to pray for us and have a few moments for those of us who carry a bit of disappointment. Who carry a bit of disappointment. Where hopes have not been kind of fulfilled. That proverb, isn't there? Hope deferred makes the heart grow sick. And some of us carry that, and they carry a bit of disappointment. So I want us to have a bit of time just to think on that as part of our response to this today. And then I want to pray, because the remedy to that and the result that it is basically to just invite God to again pour his love into our hearts, because that changes everything. So let's just pause for a moment and just remember where you stood. Remember where you're going. Yeah? Remember who you're with. And just honestly, before God, bring your disappointment now. See, I'm disappointed. I'm going to pray, Holy Spirit, come and soften hearts right now. And, you know, I think there might be people in the room who are a little bit, when I say angry, I'm not necessarily talking about raging at God, but just a little bit angry at God for whatever. So I just want you to bring that to him. I think it's birthed and born out of just wanting to see circumstances and situations different and wondering why. But bring your anger with God, your frustration, and your disappointment to him. And I just pray, Holy Spirit, come and do some healing now, please. Come and do some healing. We're going to stay here a while, just a little bit longer. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus. Move. Beautiful Savior. Beautiful Savior. Just well, we continue. Just we're going to sing a song. It's a beautiful song of invitation. And it's an invitation to come to the altar and just bring whatever we're sort of carrying or feeling right now. And this is not going to be for everybody, but there are for some, I'm absolutely convinced that for some, this is for you today, that there's going to be breakthrough here. There's going to be some release and some freedom, some making sense of things that have left you puzzled. So let's just sing this. If you want to stand, stand. If you want to stay seated, seat. If you want to come, find a space to kneel, find a space to kneel. Come to the altar.
verse back up, please, Andrew, if that's okay. Number 5. Hope does not disappoint. So flood our hearts with hope, Lord. Then it says this, but God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. So again, if you're able to stand, I'd like to ask you to stand. And we're just going to pray for that outpouring, because I don't care what you say. I think we all need this every day, every minute of every day. We need the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We need the outpouring of his love into our hearts, because this changes everything, doesn't it? So just ask the Lord to fill you afresh. Come, Holy Spirit. I can pray it. I can pray it and pray it and pray it. But when you pray it, when you pray it, then it really starts to move. Come, Holy Spirit. Just pray it where you stood. Remember where you stood? What you stood on? Grace. Divine enabling, his favor. Who you stood there with? Your Father, in his presence. Why wouldn't he just fill you in this moment? And what he's given you? Hope. Revealed his glory, his favor. Come, Lord Jesus, we just pray. Holy Spirit, come. Just keep praying it for a bit. We're just going to stay here for a moment. Beautiful Saviour. Yeah, I believe the Lord wants to set a fire in our hearts today. Would you like that? Fire of the Holy Spirit burning within you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. Would you make that your prayer today? Ask you again. Would you make that your prayer today before God? Do you think we can sing that? Can we make it our prayer this morning? It's just praying, singing what we're praying. Come, Holy Spirit, set a fire down in my soul. What do you think, Mark? Can we do it? I think we can sing it without musicians. Danny, do you want to just start us off? Set a fire down in my soul.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire.
Jesus, come.
Just as we're kind of praying and worshipping, I'm just, over the last 3 years, I think I've realised that that verse of suffering producing character, producing perseverance, producing hope, it's a process. It's not somewhere that we are automatically at. And I just felt as we're worshipping that there are people who are in that process and would be loved to be saying, yes, I'm in that place of hope. But as we started singing that last chorus, I had this picture of parched land, completely dry land, complete drought. You know, when you can see the land and it's so dry that it's got those big cracks between it. And if you leave land that long, when the rain starts to fall, it doesn't soak in. It just sits on the top for a while. And I think we should go back into a time of worship. But as we worship, if you are in that place, just let the Spirit land on you. Don't try and force it. You won't be able to. You don't need to stand in God and say, I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. If you're in that process, just let him soak you. Because that land needs to be absolutely drenched, absolutely soaked in his Spirit before it can draw in again. So let's go back into worship. And if you're in that place, just let him rain on you. Just let him pour into you. Just let him soak into you and drench him up, soak him up and rest in him. Father, I want to pray. I want to pray for those people that are in that place. I know what it's like. I've been there. And it's hard. It's hard. And I want to say well done to you for getting here this morning if you're in that place. Well done for putting yourself in the position of accepting God and being obedient to him. Lord, I want to pray for those people that are feeling like a dry land. And I just ask as we go back into worship that you would soften that land, that you would allow your Spirit to just soak in, to soak up, that those roots that have become hardened and shriveled and dry, that they would just begin to soften again so that they can start soaking up. Holy Spirit, minister now. Minister now to those people that are dry, those people that are hurting, those people that have been through so much suffering that they can't, don't know whether they're coming or going. Lord, minister now to them. Pour in your Spirit, Lord. Snot and tears and emotion is absolutely fine. If that is you right now, it's okay. Just want to say as a church, it's okay. We do snot, we do tears, it's fine. Just let him minister to your heart. Pour in, Jesus. Pour in, Holy Spirit.
Jesus.
Going to just wrap things up formally in terms of the sort of our order, if you like, but we are going to pray for people. So, two things. If you want to have that fresh touch, the fire of the Holy Spirit burning within you today, I believe it's available for us all, and we'd like to pray for that for you. And we're just going to pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Nothing complicated. You know, we've made the environment right as you've gone through this time together today. And we're just going to pray, come, Holy Spirit. And I believe he wants to touch people today. So I'm going to ask you to come down. There'll be some music playing. But we're going to come down and we're going to lay hands on you. And if that's a hunger in your heart for more of God, if there's a hunger in your heart for that baptism, that fresh touch of your Holy Spirit, of the Holy Spirit, come down and we're going to pray that for you today. Second thing, I really, as we were worshiping then, the phrase is, if your disappointment is holding you back, I want to pray for you. If your disappointment is holding you back, if you're disappointed with God, disappointed with, I don't know, whatever, the way something's worked out or something that didn't happen that you wanted, if you're disappointed and it's holding you back, it is a process, absolutely, but today might be a real catalyst in that process in terms of maybe pushing you forward into that. So we'd like to pray for you, and there'll be some people here to pray for you. If there's not somebody straight away, just wait, we'll get to you. But would you come? And for the person who sat there thinking, this is not my thing, I don't go down the front, can I just say something to you? It's your thing. It is your thing. Because sometimes it just takes a little bit of effort, a little bit of faith to put one foot in front of the other, and God will meet you in that. He'll meet you in it. And it will just, I think it can basically almost exaggerate, increase the impact of what you've already done with him today. Does that make sense to everyone? So there will be some music playing. The rest of you are free to go. Have a wonderful week. But if you want prayer, we're going to pray. And I believe God is going to move. Yeah? So just come down when you're ready. The rest of you, have a great week. And we will see you next week.